I think you notice there's Kleenexes at the table. There's a reason for that, and that's about our next presenter. Normally, Steve, the head of the speakers committee, would present the speaker, but I asked if I could do it because having Tricia here is a fulfillment of a dream of mine. About 3.5 years ago, we came across an article that looks like this in the Texas Dallas Morning News. It told Tricia's story, an amazing story, and Jim Cummings had no knew this story. And we decided we'd go over. She's Tricia is the admissions director and the head volleyball coach at Bishop Lynch High School over in Dallas. We drove over and bought her a St. Therese ministry thing, and I got a very nice thank you note, and then we began talking about trying to get her to be a speaker here. And this is 3 years later. It took us 3 years to get the time to be here. Tricia has won the state championship in volleyball 5 years, so she's got an amazing gift as a coach, but she's got many other amazing gifts too. So I won't talk anymore. I'll let Tricia come up and tell her story.
Thank you, Bob, and thank you guys for having me here. As Bob said, it's taken a while for me to get here. I was supposed to be on the agenda last year at this time, but my third little one came into the world back there, Andy. So if you hear some screaming and crying, that's her. So, yep, that's it, right there. So obviously it was a little difficult last year at this time for me, but we started sleeping again, and so we feel pretty good. My name, like you said, is Tricia. I work at Bishop Lynch High School down over in Dallas, and I've been there for about 12 years. I started in 2005, and before that I was at Baylor and actually worked at Riker Catholic, and just loved the Catholic school system. I myself was a public school kid from the middle of the country, so I really didn't have much exposure to Catholic schools, but my family is Catholic, and it meant a lot for a lot of my family growing up in Catholic schools, and so I felt very at home when I got to Bishop Lynch. So I guess before my story, I would have had a very normal story. I graduated from Baylor. My husband is a year younger, Jonas, and so we moved to Dallas, got married, and then Cameron entered the world in 2011. So that's Cameron. He's currently a kindergartner at St. Thomas Aquinas in Dallas. And things were going really well. And so when Cameron turned about 3, he started noticing that a lot of his friends were getting babies. So of course, the natural thing for a 3-year-old to do is to ask mom and dad to give him a baby. So we prayed about that and talked about that, and we were ready to have another child. And so in May of 2014, 3 years ago, almost to the day, we found out we were pregnant. And so we were going to give him his baby. And we actually had planned a trip to Sweden, where Jonas is from, and got to tell his grandmas together that we were having another baby, and started telling friends. And we went to a doctor's visit around 8 to 10 weeks along, and she told us that there is, kind of a new technology where they just take a blood sample of mine, and they're actually able to figure out gender. And of course, there was another panel of things that they could find out, but not to worry about that. It's very rare, it's uncommon, and if we really wanted to know gender, just take this little blood test. And I'm a planner, so I like to be able to plan things in advance. And I had 10 bins of baby boy clothes in the garage, preventing me from parking my car in the garage. So I figured, well, if it's a girl, I could get rid of that and start decorating a room pink. So we did the blood test and really didn't think much of it. And I was actually in Portland, Oregon at a work conference for admissions, and I got the call from my doctor. And we're in a room just like this. When I got the call, it was very busy. There was a couple hundred people eating lunch. And so my doctor was trying to tell me something, and it seemed a little bit more serious. Usually the nurse is the one who calls, but it was my doctor. And she asked me if I could step away and go outside. So literally just like this setting, there were some little gardens, and there was an area for me to step away for a minute, and so I did. And I said, okay, what's going on? Did you get the test results back? And she said, yes, I did. And there's something a little bit concerning. And I was like, well, what's the gender? She said it was a girl, but that my test came back positive for trisomy 18. So I've heard of Down syndrome, and that's trisomy 21, but I'd never heard of trisomy 18. Never had anyone that I knew, I've never heard of it, basically. So I said, okay, well, that's, what does that mean? And so she said, well, this is fatal. This is a fatal condition. So of course I'm like all of a sudden absorbing real news and information coming through to me. And I distinctly remember just standing in a little garden by a tree and like collapsing because I didn't know what was happening. And so she said, you know, where are you? Portland, Oregon. I like go to one work conference every 3 or 4 years. Okay, well, don't Google anything. Get on a plane and come home. So what do you do first? You start Googling. So I jumped in a taxi, didn't go back to the hotel for my luggage, got in a plane, couple layovers later, ended up back in Dallas. And of course there were thunderstorms and every reason preventing me to come home that night. And every person I was on the plane with, hysterically crying next to, was just doing their best to not make eye contact and to stay away because the awkward girl was crying the whole flight. And apparently nobody likes to ask what's wrong with you. So we made it back into Dallas, and the first stop was to a doctor to confirm that this was indeed positive, because it is possible to have a false positive on these blood tests. So that's kind of what we were hoping for and assuming that was, okay, this can't be real, it's a false positive. And so there's a doctor in Dallas that most women are referred to with positive tests, and he has kind of more advanced sonogram equipment and the ability to kind of foresee some of these circumstances. So very quickly when he turned on his equipment, he realized, yes, this is a trisomy 18 baby. There's particular markers with some swelling in the back of the brain and the hands and the crossed feet. There was just some markers. And so it was confirmed. And, you know, his first reaction to me was, well, schedule the termination. And I said, what? You know, I mean, of course I'm processing a million things at once. And I'm thinking, maybe he's saying this because my health is in danger. Like, why would you tell me this? And, you know, he was like, well, you know, just meet with my nurse, talk to your doctor, just, you know, schedule the induction is what they'll call it. So I was, of course, very confused and just left the office that day and, you know, followed up with my doctor. And my doctor, luckily, was very supportive, but supportive of, you know, whatever decision we made. And so we went home, and actually luckily because I was supposed to be on a work trip that week, I had, you know, no work to go back to. I kind of already farmed off everything in the office. And so we spent days just locked in the house, crying, processing, Googling, you know, trying to figure out what was going on and how our lives would change. And I distinctly remember getting a call back from that same doctor. And when I told him that, you know, terminating the pregnancy or inducing was not an option for us, that we were planning on, you know, continuing with this pregnancy as long as God would allow and just seeing what happens. You know, he specifically said, well, didn't your son say he wanted a sibling? I said, yes, he's still getting a sibling. Well, but why waste your time with that? Move on, you know, move on to the next pregnancy that can be healthy. So it really opened my eyes to what the medical community and how some of the medical community, you know, views pregnancies that have complications. And that was just the first of, you know, many other doctor's appointments at various places that we went to that had a very negative outlook. So the next week, I was scheduled to have volleyball camp at Bishop Lynch. And typically at our high school, we have about 90 girls that will try out for volleyball. I have 4 full teams of girls. I coach the varsity. Season starts on August 1st, and all of this happened on July 15th. So I knew that I had to figure out very quickly how I would communicate this message, how I would, you know, be able to process this information. And the other thing is with my job in admissions, I meet new people constantly. We typically in a calendar year will have about 700 applicants apply to Bishop Lynch. And so of course, when you're pregnant and your stomach is, you know, popping out, everybody asks questions. When's the baby due and what's going on and what's the baby's name? So, you know, it really took me, there was a lot of processing that happened very quickly. And of course, I think in any tragedy, which I'm sure all of you in your lives have been through something, maybe not the same, but similar, you ask God, why? Why me? Why this? I'm young, I'm healthy, like, why? Why is this happening? And then just the fear of the unknown, because statistically they will say that only 10% of women that are pregnant with a trisomy 18 baby make it full term. Usually it's a stillbirth. And then I'm thinking of all the cases, all the scenarios, like what do I do if the baby dies in the womb, and what if she does survive, and what do our lives look like, and how do you take care of a baby with special needs? Again, I'm the planner, right? So I think that, you know, in one way that my doctor coming back in the last minute at that 8-week appointment, telling me about this blood test was really a blessing, because for me, I just needed time to process and time to plan. And the other thing I think is, the one thing my sister said, she was kind of very helpful to me through this whole journey, was, you know, Tricia, if this happened to me, she's a stay-at-home mom, she kind of works part-time. She said, you know, I don't really have a platform. Some of my friends would know what was going on in my life, but you know, God has given you a platform. You're a head coach at a big high school. You're the admissions director. You know, people know who you are. And, you know, she really encouraged me, like, tell your story and tell people that it's okay to choose life, regardless of the circumstances that you're going through. And show them that through a tragedy of a child dying and not understanding why, that there's still hope in the Lord, and that seeking Him above all things is the most important thing. And show people that your faith is strong enough. And so I said, okay, you know, I'm going to do the best that I possibly can through the circumstances. I kind of had just a little script, like a very short script in my head when people would ask me questions. And I did spend a lot of time with my volleyball team, because they're teenage kids. They're very formidable, 15 to 18 years old, explaining to them what was going on. And you know, the best thing for me in those next few months was the fact that I had this community that was rallying around me. I had this great team of girls that, you know, if you've ever worked with teenagers, they whine and complain all the time. And, you know, I guess I'm immune to it to an extent, kind of ignore it. And I will say we have really good kids at BL, and so maybe it's a little less than average, but it's still up there. And I remember we have this retreat at the beginning of the year, and I just said, you know, girls, with the things that I'm going through, I have really bad days and I have good days. And if all you do is just in practice, work your hardest, like, you know, show me that you're having fun. Don't complain, like, the best that you can, unless it's something actually serious. That will be very helpful to me. And I think through that experience, it really taught teenage kids how to be selfless. I will say, as a person that works at a high school, we're always asking the kids, how are you today? How are your grades? How are you feeling? How's that relationship going with your best friend? Is she still mad at you, or are you best friends again? Is she mad again, or best friends again? How's that boy? It's rare that teenagers ask how you are doing as an adult. But all of a sudden, teenagers cared how I was doing and how the pregnancy was going and how I was feeling. And, you know, and that was hard for me sometimes, because I thought I had to just always fake a smile and act like everything was okay. But I came to the realization that in real life, in real tragedies, and what God puts all of us through every single day, it's not supposed to be easy. And you're not supposed to just cruise through life. Some people view Christianity as, well, you know, if you're a Christian and you believe, things are just going to go your way because you're better, you know, you're good. But that's not it at all. In fact, sometimes God will challenge you in more ways, because when He asks you to trust Him, He will put something in your way that might prevent you from trusting. And so there, it was just very, you know, eye-opening for me with through the girls and through my situation and what we were going through, how God was really challenging my heart. And, you know, we were a nervous wreck for months. That was another thing that I think God says. I had to read the verse very many times, do not be anxious about anything. So I just sit there, don't be anxious, don't be anxious, don't be anxious, because especially in pregnancy, when you're supposed to relax and keep your blood pressure low, I was constantly thinking of every scenario, the what ifs, and how will I do this, and how will we cope with this, and it was just kind of in the back of my mind that God was saying, let go, let go, let go, stop, and trust. And And what was really, you know, good for me was that in the last month before we had Annabelle, I really got very anxious and had to just really give it up completely, or else I was going to go crazy. And our volleyball season ended on about November 10th. We won the state championship that year. It was our third in a row. And so that season, you know, you're always building in a sports season for the next game, the next game, the next game, the next tournament. Then that just ended. And so I had about 6 weeks to just focus in on this path, this journey, and what to do. And so, you know, Annabelle, through every single doctor's appointment, surprised and shocked every single doctor that we met with. I ended up probably going to the doctor in the end every 5 to 7 days because I had my doctor, my OB, and then we had a specialist at the fetal care center that was constantly monitoring the fluid levels and her progress and growth because she had a heart condition. She only had a 2-chamber heart, and that was concerning. And then obviously there's other indicators that are very concerning that they felt that along the way, you know, if I was at least close to full term or getting to full term and maybe her heart rate would drop, that, you know, we'd try to get her alive. And, you know, I was prepped by all the doctors that she would not live. There was no possible way. You have two, you're supposed to have 4 chambers in your heart. She only has 2. And I was terrible at science, but that seems like it makes sense. And so, you know, in those last few weeks, every week, she's still going, she's still alive, she's still growing. And it was really awesome to watch how the doctors, my doctor and the fetal care center doctors, just witnessed this miracle happening in front of them. And so, actually, my little makeshift slideshow, that was our pregnancy announcement with Cameron, only child expiring January 2015. Her original due date was the first week of January. And then I have my little sonogram picture up here. So the time came when it was around Christmas, I guess about 2 days before Christmas, and my doctor said, all right, you're about to be 38 weeks. That's considered full time. The fluid is just rapidly building because she wasn't able to process the amniotic fluid. We might be getting to a point where it's going to be dangerous for her inside the womb, and we might need to get her out. Said, you know what? I've been pregnant long enough and I've made it this far. That is the goal, right? Like, get her out and hopefully she is alive. And so we did schedule a C-section on December 29th. And, you know, that whole Christmas season of just the birth of a child, and I'm like about to birth a child with so many uncertainties, it was hard. And it also made a whole new perspective of what Mary went through on the donkey and riding in and so many uncertainties. Believe me, I'm not married, and this, I did not have Jesus, but, you know, I felt like there was so much connection there with what I was going through and what we were going through as a family and the anticipation of a birth. And so when Annabelle was born, we had her at Baylor Hospital in downtown, and prior to the birth, we met with the NICU and a whole lot of doctors, and I asked them, so, doctors that have a lot of years of experience, when's the last time you had a live birth that was a baby with trisomy 18? And the room was silent. No one had experienced a birth that was a live birth or a trisomy 18 birth. I said, okay, am I in the wrong place? Because this doesn't sound good. And they were like, no, honestly, there's just no place that has really had experience with trisomy 18 babies. And okay, that's cool. Let's figure this out. And so of course in the C-section, that was the safest way to get her out. They believed that labor would be too difficult on her heart and that she potentially wouldn't survive. So I distinctly remember, you know, being in the OR, and they told me, you know, that this is kind of different. So we're going to have a lot of doctors in here and a lot of nurses in here to just witness this miracle and to see what's going on with this baby that is not even supposed to be here at this point. So with a million doctors and nurses in the room, she came out and there was nothing. No cry, no peep. There was a lot of action in the room. And of course, I'm kind of drugged up and very stressed and trying to figure all of this out. And silence again. So about 2 or 3 minutes went by, and the head of the NICU, Julie Crawford, came to me, and she was like, "Tricia, it's not happening. She's not breathing. She's blue." Like, preparation, preparation, preparation. And while she's talking to me, all of a sudden, there's a cry. And so, I remember that so distinctly. And I just remember, like, praise God, like, this is happening. She's alive. And so, you know, I'm like, "Julie, go back. Like, get back over there. She's alive." And so what they did is, if you've heard of, like, kangaroo care, you know, throw all the medicine and the, you know, stuff that they're trying to resuscitate babies with out the door. They just want the baby on their chest. And the second she was on me, she was breathing. She turned pink. She was, like, alive. She opened her eyes. And all of a sudden, you know, no one knows what to do, because this was not supposed to happen. So I actually, this was in the hospital, but, and you know, some of these pictures, like, you can see, she's just normal, like, fine, alive. She was tiny. She was 3 pounds, 13 ounces, but lots of babies are 3 pounds, 13 ounces. And, you know, at that point in time, we were in, okay, what do we got to do mode? What do we got to do to keep her alive? What do we have to do to keep her here? And, you know, at Baylor, I was so blessed to find a lot of Christian nurses and doctors, and very encouraging, very supportive. But at this point, because of the little experience they had, it was all about comfort care. The assumption was, well, you know, she's going to die, so let's just keep her comfortable. And so as a mother seeing your child, you're like, well, I want to feed her. I want to help her. I want to make sure that we keep her going. And that really wasn't really the mindset for most of the doctors in the hospital. And, you know, every day was going by and she was still there. I had so many nurses, you know, because a lot of times they work shifts. So they're a couple days on and they go off for a couple days and then they come back. And so every time a nurse is, you know, with me for a day or two and hysterically crying that she'll never see this baby again, a couple days later she's back, you know, and there's the baby. And so we spent about 5 days in the hospital. No one prepared me to go home with this baby. It was not possible. Yet here we are, they're packing my bags, they're telling me it's time to get out of here and bring your baby home. So, you know, we were blessed with 6 days with Annabelle, 150 hours. She spent probably 148 of those on my chest. It seemed like any time we passed her around, she would have trouble breathing. She definitely, with her heart condition, had a lot of trouble breathing. And so if she was on her back or her side, there were several episodes where she just stopped breathing completely and they would kind of massage her body and revive her back. They told me that because of the trisomy 18, it was impossible for her to have the sucking reflex. So they put me on the pump to get some milk out, and day two, start sucking. Put a little Q-tip in there, like, with some milk, and she wanted it. And, you know, I think that if one doctor out there changed their view of how to treat a disabled baby like Annabelle, or one nurse, and if it really changed their heart and how they treat, that it was well worth it, if that's the sacrifice that I had to make. And, you know, the care that we received in the hospital was great, but again, it wasn't really to keep her and to really, like, keep her alive. It was just to let her go and let her die. And when we got home on the fifth day, we just knew, we could tell she was hungry and she wanted milk, and she kind of at that point was very weak and did stop sucking. And one of the Baylor nurses went up to the hospital, got equipment, and just brought it straight over to the house and was like, you know what? They didn't want to put a feeding tube in her at the hospital because of the liability. They thought it might be too dangerous, she might aspirate, but I'm going to do it because I think that's what she needs. And, you know, that could have been done on day one, but they were so scared about, you know, what liability could exist if they did it incorrectly, or, oh, this is just supposed to be for comfort care. We don't need to, you know, waste time and equipment and resources on this baby. So they gave her a feeding tube, and we just could tell after a little bit of milk in her belly, as soon as it hit, she just was in heaven and passed out and slept so well that night. And she ended up passing away, and in the middle of the night, and I was there, Jonas was there, my sister was there all during it. And it really wasn't until I guess, after her life that I really started seeing the impact and the effect that she was having. And one thing I think about often is that, you know, people can go a whole lifetime living on this earth and just going through the motions and just living life. And that little baby in 6 days made more of an impact than so many people will, especially non-believers. And I just, you know, seeing the effects of her life. One thing, very early on in my pregnancy, I had this dream, and it was very strange because it was just this huge church full of people, kind of like a big memorial service. And I remember thinking, huh, that'd be weird, because if she's not gonna survive this and it's gonna be a stillbirth, like it'll probably be very low key and no one's probably gonna know about it. But when we had the memorial service for Annabelle, hundreds and hundreds of people were there. And the story in the Dallas Morning News that Bob spoke of, it brought lots and lots of hundreds of comments, and some of them were very negative against me. Like I was punishing this baby for trying to have her live. But there was a lot of support as well. And then my sister started a Facebook page called Annabelle's Army, and it was kind of really her goal just to communicate mass messages during our time in the hospital to friends and family. Because instead of sending a million text messages, it was like, go to the Facebook page, you know, that way you can get information. And so what was meant for maybe 30 to 50 people grew to 10,000. And since then, I still to this day get messages on Annabelle's Army. Hey, I've got a friend that just had a baby that's diagnosed with trisomy 18. She wants to terminate the pregnancy. Can you call her? Can you talk to this person? I've had women reach out that have found out about the page. And actually, a month after I found out I was pregnant, one of my best friend's friend that lived in Austin had a neighbor that found out she had a baby with trisomy 18. She had told very little people. She scheduled the induction, right? And I got to her like 2 days before that, and now that baby is 2.5 years old with trisomy 18. She's like a little tiny miracle. She lives in Austin. And, you know, everything she had been told by these doctors was terminate, 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 move on. The baby can't survive. It's not possible. And now she's got a 2.5 year old. And it's just a miracle. So, you know, I hope that all of you, through tragedy and through anything you've been through, that, you know, one thing I also realize is people look to you of how you deal with a situation. So I think some people wanted me to cave. I think some people wanted to see, look at her. She calls herself a Christian, but she's mad at God and now she's rebelling. Haha, that's not really faith. God doesn't really exist. And it was hard sometimes not to be angry and not to be mad and not to ask questions and try to figure out this big, you know, maze called life. But at the end of the day, I knew and I felt in my heart that if I trusted and if I really kept the faith through all of this, that it would be okay. That was kind of the message I kept getting, was it's okay. It'll be okay. It'll be so much more than you will ever imagine. You know, we got the opportunity. My sister forced me into this little photo shoot as a family on the fifth day when we arrived. I was so mad at her. I was like, April, I haven't slept in days. I look terrible. Why are you having a photographer in my house? And she's like, get clothes on, shut up, and go to the living room. So she was able to take, you know, hundreds of beautiful pictures of our family and the time that she was able to capture in that moment. Because, you know, after this, she passed away the next day. And she got some awesome pictures of Cameron holding her in the corner and making little silly faces, and it was a blast for him too. But we were just so blessed to have that time, those memories, those pictures. And then since then, you know, Annabelle's Army kept growing. There was the March for Life that we were able to be a part of with hundreds of high school kids from Bishop Lynch and other schools that joined in and made signs and made posters and attended the mass at downtown. And kids still to this day wear the shirt everywhere, the Annabelle's Army shirt. And it's weird because I see them around town too. I'm like, hey, that's my kid, cool, you know? That's Annabelle. And then since then, you know, I think another testament is when that doctor told me well, why don't you terminate the pregnancy? Don't you want to have a sibling for your son? And yes, I do have a sibling for my son. I have two, and one's in heaven and one's here. And, you know, siblings are siblings. They're 5 years apart and they're best friends. He's enamored by everything she does, and they'll be best pals. And just because I decided to seek out, you know, my second pregnancy and see how far that would take me, did not mean that he did not still have another sibling that he can live his life with. So this is Andy. She was born on April 4th, 2016, last year, a little chunky, fat little baby. And that's some pictures of her at church and at the beach. And I think that too has been a great part of our story, because I think for some women that go through a situation like this, they wanted a baby so bad. And of course, everybody wants a healthy pregnancy. You don't want to hear that your baby has a fatal condition. And it is hard to sometimes look out far enough to realize, okay, you know, I can still have more babies later or another pregnancy down the road that might be healthy. And even if this baby passes away, it's okay. And it is okay. It's okay. And it's great. And again, if it changed one life, if it changed one heart, if it changed the way that the doctors view these pregnancies, that's okay. And that's worth it to me. Because one after effect that happened was I had the ability to sit down and talk to the head of NICU. And she's an amazing woman. But she said, I would have done so many things differently now in hindsight. And she said, this is my promise to you, Tricia, I will do things differently. It's not just going to be about comfort care and waiting for a baby to die. It's going to be about helping this baby in any way that I can to survive. Because if she would have been born and they did not know she had trisomy 18, they would have been required to go above and beyond to give her a feeding tube and oxygen and all these other things. But just because they knew of a diagnosis, they didn't want to do any of it because they just didn't think it was worth it. And that's just not fair. That's not fair to a baby who has the ability to survive, especially now knowing in hindsight, there are so many babies that do survive with trisomy 18. So that's my little story. That's my little family. I do have a little video of Cameron said it would embarrass him, which I can't imagine him ever being embarrassed because he's just a funny little guy. One thing that the Bible talks about is having the faith of a child. And I didn't really know what that meant until I had Cameron. And, you know, to Cameron, he knows that Annabelle is in heaven. And he understood, he comprehended the fact that she could not be 100% healthy on earth and that her home was in heaven. And that's, you know, was her life's plan. And, you know, explaining what happened to him, he was at his grandma's house when it happened, and explaining it when he came back was probably the worst moment of my life, explaining that to a 3.5-year-old who, when he saw that Annabelle was alive, was like, oh, cool, well, I guess she made it. Awesome. She's here. But just seeing him, and now that he's 6, it's been a few years, and when Cameron goes to get his hair cut and someone says, hey, you know, do you have any siblings? Yes, I have one in heaven and I have one on earth, Andy. And it's very easy for him. It's very black and white. There's no in between. And that, like seeing that through him, like really taught me and helped me to understand what faith is. It's not supposed to be complicated. There's not all these, you know, rules and things and things that you have to do in any kind of order. It is true faith in Jesus that brings you peace and understanding. And that's what we had during that time, because, you know, I couldn't have done that on my own. There was no way in those 6 days that I could have been like as focused and as determined to do everything I could for her and kept it together without that peace and understanding that only God can give. And that's the other thing when I, you know, have spoken at a few things and talked to people, it's always like, oh, how are you so strong? And I'm like, it's not me doing it. You know, it's truly like what God has given us as a family. And that peace and understanding. So, you know, it's simple. You know, Jesus came, died for us, and that love that God had for his son, for him to die on a cross, for us to be forgiven, is real, and it's simple. And so, anyway, I really appreciate the support that you guys, you know, gave me through the pregnancy, for Bob and for all of you that were following our story. And I will say that was the other thing, that all the prayers and just, there were so many people at the hospital when she was born. I mean, it was truly a miracle. I mean, the way that when a doctor looks at you in the eyes like, she's alive, you know, like, what? What's going on here? You know, that was God just answering prayers. And speaking to all these doctors and nurses to help them understand that this was really, truly a miracle and to view life differently. So thank you guys. Appreciate y'all for having me.
I guess the one question I have is, how do you think you felt as you aborted the child?
Well,
did that ever?
No. Well, I did want to talk to you. I did have the desire early on to just talk with anyone I could that had maybe a similar situation, that either had a stillbirth,
birth, that aborted, and just, you know, kind of hear it all. And I think a telling thing is that anyone that I had heard aborted the pregnancy did not want to talk about it. And I realized that in talking with other women and trying to encourage them to keep their pregnancy, is that you hear so much regret. And I think for me in this situation, like, I know that it was exactly how God intended it to be. I didn't have to make a choice like that. And that was the thing that I think was the burden off of me, was like, well, it's not my choice. This is going to be God's choice, God's timing. And whether it's a stillbirth or a miscarriage, or I make it to term and she dies or she lives for years, like, I just knew that, you know, God would guide us through it.
Let me tell you a story that's opposite of this. I had a real close friend down in Waco again, and her daughter became pregnant. About 2/3 of the skull was missing, and they told her there's no chance the baby's going to live. She decided, unlike Tricia did, to have the abortion. I saw her, my wife and I saw her about 3 or 4 years later, and she still was grieving not having the baby. And I don't know if she has ever gotten over that, you know. And I think that's the greatest thing, is that mom and how she reacts to it. Her grandmother was very upset about the Catholic Church jumping all over her. In fact, they left the Catholic Church over it. It's a sad story, but this is a sad story, but it had the right ending if it had to end. And I think I appreciate you coming and talking to us about it. It's just an incredible story, and we appreciate it. And we appreciate you being up here too, right? Say something.